So good evening, everyone, and thank you very much for coming to Ellisburg Farm. This is the first speaker series that we have. There will be another one in August. My name is Claudia Lipsky, and I'm lucky enough to be employed here at the Ellisburg Farm. Tonight we also have Sarah Ritchie. She was here all day, and she's here part of the night, so thank you, Sarah, for setting everything up. And we also have some board members here tonight. We have Maureen Carey, board member of Ellisburg Farm, and we have Leo DeGroot, and we have Wayne Kinsella, who is a past board member. Another person that works at the bird farm on and off is Alicia Ritchie. She does work with our bluebirds and with our purple martins, so she has interesting stories to tell as well. So tonight Leo has got a camera going, so if anyone is hiding for any reason and doesn't want their picture taken, you should leave now, because Leo would like to document the evening as Jeff is speaking. So Dr. Jeff Holroyd's interest began when he was a teenager, and he was a volunteer, actively, and a chairperson of the Long Point Bird Observatory in Ontario. He gained his education at the U of Toronto with a master's and PhD studying swallows. So this is a long-time expert on swallows. For 36 years, he was employed with the Canadian Wildlife Service, and he retired 6 years ago, and he's probably as busy as ever as when he was working. He is the current chair of the Beaver Hill Bird Observatory near Tollfield, where they're doing much of this research. He is a co-founder of the BBO, Beaver Hill Bird Observatory, which is the oldest banding station in Alberta and the second oldest banding station in Canada. So again, a long history. Something that Jeff had started a few years ago was the Young Ornithologist Workshop, and it's to get kids aged 15 to 18 hooked on birds. So they get to spend a week at the BBO, I believe, or in that area, learning from the experts and becoming passionate about the birds. So I think that's a great work that you're doing, Jeff. And he continues to be involved in research of all kinds with endangered species, conservation, and also the tree swallows. Okay, so please join me in welcoming Jeff Holroyd, Dr. Jeff.
Thanks, Claudia, and welcome. Thank you very much for coming out tonight. It's a gorgeous evening out there, and I always hate missing evenings because we get so few of them in the summer, but I'm glad that you're here this evening. Can everyone hear me okay, or do I need to wear a mic? Okay, I've got my hearing aids in, so I assume you can hear me. So as Claudia said, I'm going to tell you a story about tree swallows. It's a bit of a murder mystery, with unfortunately we don't know who's caused the murder, but just to give you a little heads up, and I'll just figure out where my buttons are here. And so, as Claudia said, this story actually starts back in 1961, when as a teenager, I was fortunate and got a chance to go out to Long Point, started banding birds, and I was already sort of a passive bird watcher. I had a few bird books, but I instantly got hooked on Long Point, on birds, and on doing bird research. So I was one of those nerdy kids where about grade 9 or so, I decided I was going to get a PhD in study birds. And 6 years ago when I retired, I told everyone I'm still the teenager living his dream, and I kept doing it, as you'll see. And when I moved from Banff, I spent quite a few years in Banff, to Edmonton, a few bird banders took me out to Beaver Hill Lake and wanted to know if I wanted to join them. Of course, with my history at Long Point, it was like, sure, but why don't we do it properly and start a bird observatory and do some real monitoring? So Beaver Hill became the second bird observatory in Canada. Long Point then started Thunder Cape. Other people got the idea. And eventually the Canadian Migration Monitoring Network was born, which now monitors birds all across southern Canada by trapping them and catching them mist nets. So in case you don't know, you know where Edmonton is, Tollfield is to the east, 50 or 80 kilometers, depending upon where in Edmonton you're measuring it. And Beaver Hill Birds is on the south end of Beaver Hill Lake, which mostly isn't a lake, I'll explain that as part of the story. So as soon as I got going at Long Point in the spring of 84, I got home that weekend, next evening during the, when I wasn't working, I started building bird boxes, because that's what I'd done at Long Point, and I can give you a whole trail of places I've left tree swallow boxes across the country, and researchers have picked up on them. And part of the story I'm telling you tonight is actually the result of some of those nest box systems. So when we set it up in 1984, there was a lake. You can see at the top there, that's blue water, not blue sky. Quite a big clearing around the bird observatory here. When it was first established, it was in a big opening in the middle of willows, and it was on the shore of the lake. So we've monitored those boxes, not completely every year, but enough that we can draw graphs, multi-year graphs. I'm afraid there's a few graphs for you to see at the start. So clutch size, the number of eggs tree swallows lay, has actually declined 10% over the 30 years that we've been monitoring. So that's roughly half an egg. Now, if one of my brothers were here, they'd want to know what the other half egg looks like. But I think you guys are smarter. They're engineers, so they talk half an egg and they don't get it. But I know you folks do. But that's quite significant. That's half an egg, so they lay six normally, and now they're only laying five and a half. And I should have mentioned, when we first set up the tree swallow grid and started monitoring them, we were part of a North American survey of productivity of tree swallows, and the tree swallows at Beaver Hill Lake produce more eggs and more young than any other tree swallow colony in North America. So a combination of being close to water, lots of food, long days, long daylight, and our tree swallows outperform all the ones in Eastern Canada and the US, so that's pretty cool. But the trend is not positive. If we're seeing a clutch size decline of 10%, obviously if you lay fewer eggs, you're going to hatch and fledge fewer young, so a decline of 9.5% of the number of young fledged. The number of nest attempts has actually declined as well. So that's actually gone down a quarter, partly due to shrubs coming up and house wrens taking over some of the boxes, but there are vacant boxes. So the question then is, why are they vacant? And nest success has declined overall 12%. So what we're seeing is a whole bunch of negative trends in a bird that used to be quite common, or is still quite common, but still worrying trends. One curious thing we found is the eggs are laid later now than they were 27 years ago or 30 years ago. Obviously, we all think of climate change involving global warming, and things should get earlier in the spring, not later. So we'll explore that in a minute. So a summary of all these negative numbers before we get into this is sort of the murder setup, whodunit. So the date of the first egg is later, clutch size is smaller, fewer young are fledged, fewer nest attempts, and a lower percentage are successful. So the question then is why? So could it be driven by later spring temperatures? Could the decline be driven by the drying of the lake? Are there pollution or pesticide concerns? And what about wintering areas? So we're trying to find out here who done it in a biological context. So the predictions of climate change is that the weather should get warmer, and a study in eastern North America found, in fact, that it is warmer in eastern North America, and the tree swallows there are laying their eggs 9 days earlier. They don't have larger clutches, but they just start and lay earlier. But May in central Alberta is actually cooler. Now, it might be hard to convince you of that given the May that we've just enjoyed.
That's right.
But we've had a lot of cold Mays. If I remember the one before that was cold and dry. So that there's obviously annual variation, but the trend is actually for cooler springs. Later nesting birds lay fewer eggs. So if they're slowed down by cooler temperatures, they're going to nest later and produce fewer eggs, fewer young. And in fact, clutch size decreased with the cooler May temperatures. So possibly one of the factors driving this change that I've mentioned is, in fact, the cooler May temperatures. And consequently, they're producing fewer young. Another factor we have to consider is the drying of the lake. So Beaver Hill Lake used to be over 50 square kilometers. You can see the outer perimeter there. You used to be able to stand on the south shore here by the bird observatory, and you couldn't see the far north shore. You felt like you were on an ocean. So in the early 2000s, the lake dried up completely. Bird watchers used to arrive. I don't remember if there were any from Red Deer, I know there's some from Calgary. I wanted to know where the lake went. And we said, we didn't know, it's gone, and we're having the RCMP investigate. The reason for its decline could constitute a whole other talk, One of the controversies is that Ducks Unlimited intercept water as it comes into Lister Lake and up to the south end of the lake in here. Here's their impoundment here, and they divert it for spring habitat on this field. So there's one person who thinks they divert enough every year, cumulatively, they contribute to the drying of the water. My other theory, alternate theory, or maybe contributing theory, is that we've had dry falls. When the water freezes dry, when the ground freezes dry, in the spring, the water runs straight into the ground, you don't get runoff. So the last 2 years, we've actually had wet falls, we've had good runoff, and Beaver Hill Lake now covers about 3/4 of the area that it covered 20 years ago. So 3/4 of the area doesn't mean that 3/4 of the volume's there, because obviously it's shallower, but still, the lake has shown signs of coming back, starting in July 2016. So why is this important to tree swallows? Well, I have to go back into my past, so I did my master's and PhD studying the diet of swallows, 5 different species, including tree swallows. And one of the things that I was able to sample what the birds were feeding their nestlings and what was available in the air column. I had these whirligig traps in my own electrical system with a generator driving these traps. And what I was able to show is that they eat a lot of midges, especially large midges. So midges, chironomids, you may have seen them around wetlands. They often form spike-like columns above trees, and if you hum, they'll come down towards you because they think you're another big column of midges. And what I was able to show is as the abundance of midges increases, the quantity that they take increases up to 160 milligrams per hour and then levels out. That's, if they can do that, that's all the young need, and that's the maximum they can ingest. But if the midges aren't there, then they actually switch to other alternate foods. But we're not going to get the whole feeding swallows. So this is from a study in Saskatchewan, just a little bit closer to home than Long Point, but it shows the same thing. So here's the abundance of midges and the productivity of tree swallows. And so you can see the midge peaks, the number of midges peak as the tree swallows are eating, or contrarily, oppositely, as the midges peak, the tree swallows kick in and lay eggs. So if they're laying fewer eggs, it could be because there's fewer midges. And midges come out of wetlands. So they're aquatic invertebrates, and they depend on water. So if you don't have a big lake, then you've got fewer midges. That gives you less food. That could result in fewer eggs and fewer young, consequently. So here's a contrasting air photo that we were able to get. This one just happened to have been taken. I don't know if the person taking it knew they were taking it, but it's posted on Google Maps showing the bird observatory in 1985 with a big clearing here. And look at the bird observatory a couple of years ago in the middle of the forest. We've actually had to start chainsawing, otherwise we'll disappear into the forest. But you notice at the top, there's no lake. So pretty graphic evidence of habitat change at the south shore of Beaver Hill Lake. But as I mentioned, in July 2016, there was a big storm that started filling the lake. You see from this small aircraft here, water starting to fill up the lake bed. And in April, my son's a whitewater kayak coach, and I phoned him and said we could run a short kayak course at the weir here, which usually you can just walk across. This was a meter or more deep, and you could easily have played around with a kayak if you like whitewater. I'm a canoeist myself. And while getting to the weir, the biologist Kevin and I started on the trail, and it got higher and higher, and finally we both looked at each other and got soakers. Uh-huh. Just like when I was a kid, but there's no mom to get mad. And that's how deep the water was, just going around the weir, never mind what was going through the weir. And then in last spring, a year ago, our staff rented a Cessna and took pictures themselves of what was happening on the lake bed. And we think that's comparable to what's out there now. And a colleague flying to Toronto happened to just get the right seat and the right view, and you can see the water filling up the lake bed in last summer of fall of 2017. So there's still quite a bit of water out there. So we're hopeful it will come back. And then again, it was flooding in the spring of this April. So we've got a couple of possible reasons for tree swallows not doing well at Beaver Hill Lake, later springs and drying of the lake, but are they? How are they doing elsewhere? Is that the only problem they've got? So we can look at breeding bird surveys across North America. These are surveys done mostly by volunteers. Claudia's just done one, she mentioned. I'm going to be doing one Monday morning in Banff. I stopped 50 times, 800 meters apart, half a mile apart, and stopped for 3 minutes and count the birds. And so it's a very standardized survey that's done all across North America. And it shows across North America the number of tree swallows detected since the late 1960s has declined at 2% per year. So the decline's not just happening at Beaver Hill Lake, it's actually much more widespread. We can look at the trends in Alberta, and Alberta's actually gone up 1.6%. But if we break it down provincially, we can see the increase has been in the prairies, actually where Beaver Hill, the blue areas, but there are declines where it's red. So British Columbia, parts of Saskatchewan and Manitoba are declining. So we've got some regional declines, but oddly enough, at Beaver Hill, where we're having a decline, breeding bird survey shows are increasing. It shows most of the increases in the prairie pothole region, so this area that we're in right now, but a bit huge decline in the boreal forest to the north of us. And that could be from tree swallows simply short-stopping, not going all the way north because there's suitable habitat here for them. And we can look at the relative abundance of tree swallows. So this isn't changed, this is just their actual density. And the darker the higher the density. So you can see central Alberta is a very important place for tree swallows compared to a lot of the country and the continent. There are other places with deep red, but we've got quite a big chunk of deep red in central Alberta. So this is definitely an important place for them. So a few years ago, there was a study of all the aerial insectivores in North America and how they were doing. Because the researchers noticed it wasn't just tree swallows declining at 2% per year. Other aerial insectivores, swallows, flycatchers, nighthawks were also declining. So they looked at their rate of change from southern Canada and the US using the same breeding bird survey data I just mentioned. And they assessed whether the trends had any geographic patterns to them. Were they coming from the north or the south, east or west? And what they found is that they were declining more in the east and more in the north than other passerines and other aerial insectivores. So there's a geographic trend. And in theory, we're on the positive side of the trend. And so you can see here the increase is more in the south, mostly with tree swallows, right? The reds are all at the northern edge of the range, except for in Alberta. Barn swallow shows an even more dramatic change. A lot of red indicating lower numbers, declining numbers, with the blue focused in the southern states, much more restricted geographic range. Kingbirds, the eastern kingbird is declining in the east, but luckily the western kingbird is doing much better than the blue on the left there. And let's get those. And so if we look at when did these declines occur in North America, there's a break point here in the late 1980s. About 1987 is where the lines are drawn. So here's our tree swallow decline, 2% per year. They were doing fine till about 1987. Bank swallows declined, cliff swallows went up, but then started declining. So what happened in the late 1980s over a broad part of North America that might contribute to the decline? So here we have to go to the next story. You've all heard about bee declines caused by insecticides, caused by the neonicotinoids, or neonics, as otherwise as a tongue twister, trying to get around it. So neonics are coated on agricultural crop, on grains, before the farmer gets them. My understanding from farmers is it's virtually impossible to buy seed that isn't already coated. It goes into the ground with the seed and stops insects from attacking that seed, but then remains active in the soil. So it's especially common in canola and corn. There's been lots of publicity about it killing bees, but bees are insects. And so it's not a bee aside, doesn't just kill bees, it kills all insects. So in fact, bees are just become the canary in the coal mine for us, and obviously beekeepers are upset and have raised the alarm. Otherwise, you know, there's nobody out there raising an alarm. If there's fewer mosquitoes, there's probably a few of us cheering it on. But if there's fewer midges, then that's contributing to the tree swallow problem. So Dr. Christy Morrissey at the University of Saskatchewan found that neonics are making their way into the wetlands. So in the spring, prior to farmers putting the seed in the ground, the neonics from the previous year are flushed into the wetlands by the runoff, by the snow melting. So the highest concentrations of neonics in wetlands is in the spring before the farmer's seed. So it's last year's neonics that are in the water and they're killing the insects. So that includes midges and other insects that aerial insectivores depend upon. So there are, of course, insects that live in rotted material on land, but a lot of our insects come out of water from the larval stage. So I guess I just explained that. So the highest concentrations are in the spring when there's runoff. And then the more recent study that she did, she looked at white-crowned sparrows and found that if they were treated with only 4 to 8 treated granules for 3 days, only 3 days, the birds lost weight and their migratory orientation was disoriented. They lost the ability to orient. So obviously birds in the wild that are getting seeds in the field, if they're stealing the farmer's crop, they're getting seeds that have any neonics on them, are going to start to get in trouble, because if you lose weight and you don't know where you're going in the wild, then you can get in trouble pretty quick. So that's one piece of bad news. Another one that I found out about from Wessels and a bison researcher is dorvermectin. So it's a group of insecticides that cows are treated with and horses, livestock, to both as an to prevent internal parasites and external parasites. So it's very effective for keeping the animals parasite-free, which is good for the animals. But the insecticide is active in cow pies, or horse poop, whatever that's called, for up to 6 months. So the researcher that in Lethbridge who looks at cow pies is finding that cow pies are lasting on the prairies for years because they aren't the insects to break them down. They have to be mechanically broken down by freeze-thaw cycles, by heavy rains, but the insects, the dung beetles, the flies that live in cow pies simply aren't able to live in them because there's still active insecticides in cow pies. So I always thought the rangeland was away from the farmers and the common use of insecticides. Turns out if there's cows and horses, they've got insects have got a problem on the open range as well. And Beaver Hill Lake has both cropland and cattle grazing. So the streams that flow into Beaver Hill Lake come off plowed land, and right around the lake is grazing land, cattle are right there. So the insects are taking a double whammy at Beaver Hill. And the effect of the insecticides isn't just local at Beaver Hill. The reason for bringing them up is they're used around North America, and they were brought into common use. They were created in the 1980s. So the decline in insectivores that seemed to start around 1987 coincides with the introduction of neonics and abramectins in North America. So now we've got a cause that could be quite broad-ranging beyond just Beaver Hill. And we had a student working at Beaver Hill Lake who was looking at the coloration of tree swallows as an indicator of aquatic pollution. I gave this talk a couple of months ago to the folks in Edmonton and pointed out that Edmonton was the polluted study site and Beaver Hill Lake was the unpolluted site, which I'm not sure the audience totally appreciated. But what the researcher found, what this graduate student found, is that the tree swallows that were raised in Edmonton, so this is a study of nestlings, where there were not as bright a blue as those that were raised at Edmonton, or raised at Beaver Hill Lake. So she doesn't know what that impact is on the whole life cycle, on their health, but definitely there's enough pollution in Edmonton that affects their coloration of the feathers while they're growing. So it's an indicator that possibly something else is going on. So we've explored some of the parameters that could be causing declines in the summer in Edmonton. What happens in the winter? Where do they go? How many of you are familiar with the studies here at the Ellisburg Farm using geolocators? Okay, I better explain what geolocators do then, just briefly. Geolocators are tiny devices that weigh less than a gram. They're put on a saddle around the legs and sit on the bum of the tree swallow or the purple martin or the bluebird that's being done here. And they only do two things. They keep track of light level and Greenwich Mean Time. And so when I first said that, it's like, well, what do you do with that? In fact, if you know time and you know light level, you can determine sunrise and sunset. And if you know Greenwich Mean Time and you know sunrise around the planet, you can determine the longitude. And if you know the longitude and date, and then you know the day length, you can estimate the latitude. So you can geolocate where the geolocator was each day. So it's not a dead accurate system. We left a geolocator down at 1-4 in the Agricultural Research Station there, and it moved a couple of hundred kilometers a day, even though it was attached to a weather station. So the interpretation is subject to variation, but it gives you a crude idea of where they're going. It's just not GPS accurate. So what did we learn about tree swallows? Well, at Beaver Hill Lake, we attached 70 geolocators over 2 summers, and we retrieved 24 of them, and this was part of a study of North America-wide study of tree swallows. Coordinated by Ryan Norris in University of Guelph. So when I mentioned earlier about tree swallow boxes that I've had a hand in putting out, I advised the group in Saskatchewan at number 8, number 6, and number 5. In my past, every time I moved, I'd have spare bird boxes, so I'd give them to a researcher, and they get hooked on how easy it was to study them. So this is the study that was done of the breeding sites. So the breeding sites are in red, all from Alaska all the way to Nova Scotia. They got about 130 geolocators back, and I have to repeat, we got 24 at Beaver Hill, so we're really happy with the portion of the study that we were able to contribute. The yellow areas are areas where they stopped over in the fall, and I'll describe that a bit more, and then the blue areas are areas that they wintered. So we were, but what they did is they ran the tracks of all 130 geolocators through a fancy program and came up with these migration routes for tree swallows across North America. So briefly, there's an Atlantic route which starts in the Great Lakes and includes some birds from Manitoba. There's Mississippi Flyway group that includes Beaver Hill Lake. So Beaver Hill is, if you don't have a pointer, it's right above my hand there. It's here. And it includes BC birds that come down the west coast. So there's 3 major migration corridors. And then the yellow ones are where birds spend a couple of months, they're molting, and then they continue south. So if we're thinking about neonics and the effect of insecticides, all of the yellow areas are also areas where agriculture is commonly used and where aerial insects could be reduced through insecticide activity. And then in the winter, the tree swallows that go down to Florida and Georgia actually become frugivores and they eat bayberry, which is a waxy coated fruit that they eat. So they still catch aerial insects, but they'll actually land on the shrubs and eat these berries, sort of like waxwings. I don't think of them doing that. So I've already mentioned the flyways. And then another researcher, another graduate student, has looked at the timing of all these events. So the inner circle of the is a year for tree swallows at lower latitudes, and the dark blue is the tree swallows that nest in Alaska. And so Beaver Hill is the second ring in. So the key message here is if you look at the 8 there in March, they all leave their wintering grounds almost at the same time, except the inner circle, they hang on for another couple of weeks in the winter before they start moving. But it takes the Alaska birds, the northern ones, So the dark blue and then the second blue in, longer to get to their breeding areas than it does the more southerly ones, and that means everything's delayed. So their departure for after nesting, their arrival in the wintering grounds is delayed, but then it all resets every March. They all take off at the same time. They just have longer distances to cover. So it's a kind of a cool study that's able to compare that. Most researchers get a handful of geolocators at one location and they can describe what their birds are doing, but here we can actually look at what the whole population's doing and compare their tracks. So specifically the ones at Beaverhill Lake, the young fledge in early July, first week of July, and within a week, the adults and the young leave, and it takes them from 3 to 6 days to get to the Dakotas or to Ohio, so the green circles there. So they move very rapidly out of central Alberta to the northern central US there, and then they spend 2 months there. So they molt all their feathers. So obviously that means there's got to be a lot of wetlands, a lot of aerial insects for them to do that. So if those areas are getting any insecticides, reducing the number of insects, that can cause them, the birds, to take longer to grow their feathers or to grow more poorly formed feathers before they leave. So middle of July, they get to their molting areas, the green circles, stay there for 2 months, the middle of September, and then most of them moved down the Mississippi. A few went straight over to Georgia and Florida. Some that went down to Mississippi hung out briefly, listening to blues bands in New Orleans. A few of them went over to Florida, and then quite a few of ours actually crossed the Gulf to the Yucatan. One went on to Honduras. Some went, we don't know if they went diagonally across or followed the coast, into Veracruz. One spent most of the winter here, and then very strangely flew all the way over to near Mexico City and hung out there for about a month before he returned. And then they all gather again in near New Orleans, listen to their last blues band, and then head back in 2 to 4 weeks back to Beaverhill Lake for the end of April, early May. So we've got a fairly complete picture now, and as a bird bander, it's kind of discouraging because what's the point of banding a bird now when we already have all this information? But there's other things we do learn from banding them, but obviously we always thought we'd be creating this map from bird band recoveries, not these high-tech devices. But there's also something else happening very strange in southwestern Alberta. So we'll infer that not you folks, but the folks in Calgary are doing something strange, or at least the tree swallows are. So here in late April 2014 is a tree at Fish Creek Park in Calgary, just covered in tree swallows. So I don't know if you folks are familiar with a program called eBird. It's run by Cornell, and bird watchers can go online and enter their bird sightings every day, several times a day. And in May of this year, they collected 1 million checklists of birds from around the world from bird watchers. And if you think there's 50 or 100 species on each checklist, they're getting a staggering number of bird records. So what a researcher did is took all the records for tree swallows and created a map for each week. So that's 52 maps for 52 weeks, and then turn them into a video. And the reason I was interested in this is what caused all those tree swallows to turn up in Calgary. Oh, so it's already started. So I hope you can read in the middle of the top there. There's April 4th, April 11th, April 18th, April 25th. And you can see the tree swallow distribution coming north from the wintering grounds, going across the center of the continent, and now we're into July 4th, July 18th. Remember I said the Beaverhill tree swallows left by then. August 15th, they're on their molting grounds. September, now we're getting into October, and so they're retreating back to their wintering areas. October 31st, November 14th. So this is a sequence of 51 maps from birdwatchers' records of tree swallows. So if you know how to identify any birds, please go on to eBird and start entering whatever birds you know how to identify. You can enter them as incidentals, which means you're not a hotshot birder, but you know what a purple martin is and know what a tree swallow are. So let me see, I'll go to the next slide. which should do the same thing. Does it want to show you something special that happens? Oops, no, I messed it up. It's kind of strange. The second slide should have been the video, not the first one. Sorry, machine. Okay, so what I'm going to try and do here, and I'll put it away. Okay, so we'll have to wait for it to click through again. Should have brought a pointer. So what we're going to do is, as they come north, we're going to watch how quickly they come up the BC coast compared to how quickly they come up the east coast of the United States and southern Canada. And what happens is they get to BC, so wherever in November, they get to BC and they come across the Rockies into western Alberta way before they arrive from the Florida population through Minneapolis. So watch here, going up the west coast much faster than the east, they're into BC, in BC, boom, see that line, look at that orange line, and then 2 weeks later, boom, they come across from Manitoba, Minnesota, the Florida population. So we've actually got two populations of tree swallows, just like we do flickers and juncos and Gellerup warblers that have got different colors separated by the ice age. We've got two populations of tree swallows, one from the west, one from the east, and the ones coming into Alberta are actually a mixture of both. More likely, the more westerly they are, the more the BC, California tree swallows, but we've got them mixing together. And I don't know anybody that's looked for any morphological difference. Obviously, there's no obvious color differences. If there's a difference in their timing, if there's a difference, what happens if a California guy hooks up with a Florida girl and they have baby tree swallows, which way do the young go? Is there a genetic component? So this introduces lots of interesting questions. It also can be interesting because we can look at, is there a difference in the places where the decline's occurring and where the birds are wintering? And subjectively, I would say there isn't. The declines appear to be regardless of where they're wintering. So it doesn't look like wintering is part of the population or part of the problem. So this is just some fun ones I put together for the talk in April in Edmonton. And you can see on April 8th, there were no Edmonton records, but there was some in BC. On the 11th, sorry, I changed the scale, but you can see there's some in Calgary, but there's none across the rest of the prairies. On the 19th, there's a couple further north in Edmonton and one in near Saskatoon. And then I was making this talk I gave on April 20th, so I thought I'm going to get a snapshot just before the talk at 3 p.m. And I went out to take a break, went down to my tree swallow boxes, and got a tree swallow. So at 3 o'clock, there wasn't one, and at 5 o'clock, I entered it onto eBird, updating it. So now my question is, there were a couple in Saskatchewan here. Did my tree swallows come from BC and from California, which looks more likely than they came all the way from Minnesota through Manitoba and Saskatchewan before they got there. So the geolocator records that we have from Beaver Hill all show our birds going southeast, but in fact, there could be part of them that are coming from BC and California. So I won't spend a lot of time in the conclusions. I think I've drummed it up to you. The tree swallows of Beaver Hill are getting fewer eggs, fewer young, nesting later, fewer pairs, and lower nesting success. But they're also declining across North America, but the decline seems to not be correlated with where they're wintering. So we can't blame it on a wintering population. It's always too easy to say, oh, it's pesticides they're using in Mexico or Central America or South America. There doesn't appear to be any relationship between where they're wintering and the declines, so I think we have to take responsibility. So the climate change effects could be the colder spring temperatures in May, the drying of the lake, dry autumns and warm springs and summers, or the increased frequency. I didn't get into cold weather events, but I know Myrna and you folks here with the mountain bluebirds have documented the effects of 3 days of cold spring weather. Could be really hard on bluebirds. Or is it a broader problem with insecticides, neonicotinoids and avermectins, that is causing a broad-scale decline of tree swallows and one by inference other areas like divorce. So a murder mystery, we don't know who's causing the problem, but certainly there's potential subjects out there. Those of you that are CBC fans and watch Murdoch Mysteries, we obviously need Murdoch on this and he figure out which one is the key problem, but it could be all of them are involved. So that's it. Thank you very much for your interest. Time for questions?
I'm a little surprised that you say they're declining, because I have quite a few guru boxes, and I think out of probably 300 boxes, I may have had two pairs, and we're talking pair, I may have had two that didn't have any swallows in it.
Yep.
And the more boxes I put out, the more swallows I get.
Right.
And it never ends. So I thought they would be on the increase, you know, and my
The key, I mean, they are doing well. We put up more boxes, so I talked here about the 50 boxes that we started in 1984. We actually have 200 boxes. We've got four different grids. So as we put up more boxes, we get more swallows.
Right.
But if we keep track of the boxes where we're actually monitoring them and monitor them every year and collect detailed information, it's not just the decline in number at that those boxes. Somebody could say, we put out more boxes, so you're diluting the number that are in your original grid. But more problematic, you're laying fewer eggs or having fewer young and more unsuccessful. So, yeah, subjectively, you walk out there and say, there's lots of swallows, it can't be a problem. But when you start looking at the numbers and actually keep track of the numbers, then something's going on.
But you did say in Alberta here, there maybe on the increase a little.
In southern Alberta, they were going up, and then in the north, they were going down, and that overall created a minus 1.5%.
And one day I was putting out some boxes, and it was, well, it was nesting time. And before I had the second box nailed up, I had swallows in the first box, and they were both for me.
Yeah.
Maybe you.
Yeah. Well, they're pretty keen. And I mean, I live on the lake east of Edmonton, and I put up eight boxes and I got eight pairs of tree swallows. So there's definitely lots around. But it's a case of keeping track of the details rather than subjectively saying that, you know, we've still got lots. So I didn't expect this result. I expected that we'd have more warmer springs and we'd have more swallows. But in fact, when we crunch the numbers, there's
so I hear rumors that barn swallows are really on a decrease.
Mm-hmm.
I know we always have barn swallows in our yard, but they're always there, so you never notice it if you got, you know, if a person hasn't.
Right, and that's one advantage of surveys like the Breeding Bird Survey, where you've got over 2,000, forget the number, it's over 2,000 routes that are run across North America. So it's a fairly extensive survey, and it's very rigorous. You start 30 minutes before local dawn, and you do it for 4 hours, repeated year after year. And so that's one of the best tools that we have for monitoring actual numbers. And a lot of we don't catch tree swallows at the birds or a tree or other migration monitoring stations, but the trends in warblers and sparrows that are found in the Breeding Bird Survey are echoed in the banding data from our bird observatories. So. Yeah.
Do you have a piece of paper with plans on how to build these bird boxes?
You can Google them and they're everywhere. I bet there's, well, Myrna actually produced a book on different kinds of boxes, including tree swallows, okay, purple martins. Tree swallows and bluebirds basically take the same size. Mm-hmm. But yeah, they're available on the internet widely. Yeah.
I'll give you a little tip. If you're building bluebird boxes, when I started building them, I didn't have a 9/16 inch grill.
Mm-hmm.
So I said, well, what's the difference? I'll go with 1 5/8. Didn't work. Starlings.
Yeah.
But 1 9/16, they can't get in.
Yeah.
I couldn't believe it.
Yeah, and if you have purple martins, they're an even bigger problem, and you end up going, we modified our, between me and friends in the bird surgery, three different purple martin boxes. And we finally got rid of the holes and put in these half circles to try and keep the starlings out.
Yeah.
But I hope there's no starling lovers here, because we ended up putting a starling trap in. Some are pretty persistent. And my friends who have the other martin box also have raised peregrine falcons. So They really like starlings.
You said the tree swallows are eating midges. Do you know how many midges tree swallows eat?
It's in my thesis.
How did you find that out?
I processed about 90,000 insects. And in my thesis defense, one of the professors, of course, the problem is I left, I did my graduate work and then left Ontario in 75, and then finally finished it in 90, defended it in 83. So I squirreled away in Banff and evenings and weekends, processed all these insects. And one of the profs said, did you ever think of subsampling? Like just do half of them or a quarter of them? Like why do you have to do every insect? So what I did is I put pipe cleaner collars around the necks of nestlings for 30 minutes. So swallows, purple martins, are fed a bolus of insects, a blob of insects. So if you think of a swallow flying around catching midges, there can be 50 to 100 midges wrapped up in saliva in its mouth as it's doing this, and then it arrives, the young are begging, and it feeds them this lump of insects. So if you put a pipe cleaner around their neck can't expand to swallow the lump. So every 30 minutes I go back and pull the lump out. Right? So I did that for an hour and a half every 3 hours. I lost track, it's in my thesis. So that gave me how many insects each young was being fed for an hour and a half. And then I replicated it from dawn till dusk. So now I've got a time frame and I've got a number of insects. And I can multiply that over the number of days. And I did it at different ages, right? So when they're quite small, they're fed smaller bolus with actually smaller midges. But through the bulk of their growing period and when they're growing feathers, that they prefer the large midges. So I was able to describe a hierarchy where I showed that one graph. If the number of large midges drops down, then they start eating medium-sized midges. So if there's a lot of medium-sized midges, but a lot of large midges, they ignore the medium-sized ones and feed the big ones. The big ones drop down, they go to medium ones. The medium ones drop down, they go to smaller ones. Smaller ones drop down, and they start to overlap with barn swallows. And barn swallows catch large-bodied insects like house flies, some deer flies, but that kind of stable flies, that kind of size of insect. But if the barn swallows larger, flies aren't available, then they'll switch to midges. And I could go on with bank swallows and all the other ones, the eastern kingbird and purple martin. But, so anyway, that's what I did for my PhD. Just processed 90,000 insects to figure that out.
Are there good questions?
I'm afraid I'll talk more about my thesis.
I'm wondering about the visual system of these birds, how they can pick up on insects which are relatively small at such a distance. They must have tremendous acuity in their eyesight.
Yeah, they're obviously way better than we are, and they're doing it at speed, right? It's not a case of having a dinner plate and somebody's moving it. We're talking 20 or 30 kilometers an hour and picking out an insect and grabbing it. So their visual acuity and their aerial skills are way better.
What's their range from their feeding area to their nesting?
I didn't actually track them, but I would say about a kilometer typically, maybe a bit further. Mm-hmm. So they don't go a long way. So where you get a dense, like at Beaver Hill, we have a dense colony of tree swallows. One has to wonder, is there even enough food? Mm-hmm. But there was 30 years ago, so why isn't there now? Or in fact, is the insect decline causing them to start to run out of food? There's a lot of detailed work that goes into figuring out some of those answers.
Can you tell the difference between a male and a female?
Tree swallow, no.
Okay. Just wondering if you could do it any better.
Only in the hand with a root patch. Okay. But no, not when you're flying.
Well, that was fascinating, wasn't it?
Mm-hmm.
Yes, so much information, and the longevity of Jeff's studies, I think, is so valuable. Right, because you've been doing this for a long time, you understand.
Well, and it's not just me, as I showed in the first slide, and what's not listed there are all the summer assistants that were out there every year, and of course they're bird banders, so they want to band the young, so you need to keep track of each box and when are the young the right age. So as a result, we end up with all this information that we can now kind of one of the, I'm sure some of you have had the same experience. You start something not realizing 30 years later what you started and where you're at now. But, yeah.
Well, thank you for doing that all those years and for presenting to us tonight. That was very good. So this was our first adult speaker of the summer. We are going to have another talk in August. And it is August 11th, The Sex Life of Garden Bugs. Should be very interesting. And also for you, there's a morning with the Martins that Alicia's going to be running over the August long weekend, I think it is. So you can come here for your coffee and muffins, sit outside with the birds. And we have a schedule of events. There are family nature nights also being held on a Saturday night. We have two more this summer, so you can grab grandkids or neighbors or just come yourselves. We do, but you have to be willing to sing and play games because it is to get kids excited about nature. So we're doing some evening events because it's such a beautiful place to share in the evening. And tonight I would invite you to stay a little bit longer, wander the grounds. I think the buildings will be locked for sure by 9 o'clock, and I'm staying late to do a bat count. So that'll happen after the sun goes down. So you're welcome to stay a little bit longer.
Can I mention two other things? One, I wanted to do my own promo for the Young Ornithologists. So 2 years ago, Claudia said I did it, but I actually didn't. Helen Treffery started the Young Ornithologist program. She just wanted to name it after somebody, and I said it's okay. She actually snuck behind me and got the whole board to agree to it. So I agreed, so long as she didn't call it the Holroyd Memorial. but the kids come out for a week, they camp and they work with the biologists. We get other experts in, they do butterflies, bats. We go out to the Treffery Farm and visit peregrine falcons. We come to my place to go canoeing, and it's free. The kids just have to get somewhere close to Edmonton, and we'll pick them up and get them out there, or their parents can drop them off. For some kids these days have got cars way before I ever got one. So there's still openings. We only take 8 kids. So if you have any children or grandchildren that are all interested in nature, they don't have to be hardcore birders. We'll teach them what a bird is and how to identify them. It's the second week of April. I think it's like the 5th to the...
August?
Yeah, August, sorry. Yeah. So go to our website or come up and chat with me afterwards, but there's still openings. We're going to run it even if it's not full, but it kind of surprises me that there aren't more teenagers, or possibly we're just picking the wrong week and kids can't take a week off in August if they've got a summer job. And if that's the case, maybe we should move it to the end of August. But
what's the age?
13 to 18. Or 14 to 18.
It said 15 on the computer.
15 yeah. To 18, yeah. I thought we were too young. So 15 to 18. So we're trying to take kids that are, you know, responsible and, mm-hmm. and quotes, adult. But we have supervision. There's adults there all the time, as well as our staff. And they get good, wholesome food. And Helen will rant if anybody wants their Cheerios. Helen will rant about how bad processed grains are for us versus raw food. And yeah. It's more than just birds. Oh, and the second one was, have a look at the research by Leo, Alicia, and others on purple martins and mountain bluebirds. It's similar to what I showed you tracking tree swallows, and it's a whole new world now that we can actually track these birds, see where they're going, what environments are they subjected to beyond just in our own backyards.
Thanks.
Thanks for coming out.